Friends, join with us as we travel back to 1967, a time when none of us were alive. We're talking history now. We can't say that we were in junior high or whatever we normally say.
For the rest of the year, we were pre-born.
I feel so young.
None of us were twinkles in anybody's eyes at this point. But 1967 was a big year, first and foremost, and especially apt, given the movie that we're about to talk about. Thurgood Marshall became the first Black justice in American history, on the Supreme Court, just as the same year as Loving versus Virginia, which I love that Loving was their last name, because that's what they were about, for interracial marriage was argued before the court. So that is celebrating its 55th anniversary this year. Very close to being on the edge again, but we're hoping that that's not going to be the case. Arab forces attacked Israel, beginning the Six-Day War, also known as the Yom Kippur War, which I would be hard-pressed to see if anybody actually knows it as the Yom Kippur War. I'm a Jew, so I do, but I don't know. We'll see. The first heart transplant was performed by Dr. Christian Barnard. And very exciting, Texas Instruments debuted the first handheld calculator. Who had a TI-83?
Yeah.
I mean, the fact that my parents were okay spending like $150 on a calculator that I literally used maybe collectively for 6 months blows my mind every time I think about it.
I just remember when in math class, like, you were not only allowed to, you were told to bring a calculator as like part of your school supplies. That was the coolest thing. And do elementary school kids even have that restriction, like no calculators in math? Do they still have to learn how to do basic math?
How are you going to spell boobs? How are you going to spell boobs if you don't have a calculator?
You know, the really important questions are always asked by Alex.
I mean, that was a pivotal moment in my childhood growing up when we realized that we could do boobs on the calculator. And that also came out really poorly. But you all know what I mean.
We were there.
And last but certainly not least, this is a crazy year for movies. We certainly had a Dickens of a time trying to narrow it down to one. This year was The Graduate, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, Bonnie and Clyde, To Sir with Love, Cool Hand Luke, and In Cold Blood, which I actually just read the book by Truman Capote for the first time, I'd say probably within the last 4 to 5 years. It's unbelievable. So if you have not read In Cold Blood, I hear the movie is good. I've not seen the movie, but if you have not read the book, it's not long. I think it's like under 200 pages. Oh, wow. It's fucking phenomenal. And also amazing and phenomenal is the movie that we're just about to talk about, In the Heat of the Night.
Memories light the corners of my mind. Misty watercolor man.
Of the way we were, scattered pictures of the smiles we left behind, smiles we gave to one another.
Welcome back, everybody, to the first episode in our 60s and 50s interstitial episodes. I'm Matt.
I'm Allie.
I'm Eric.
And joining us today is a new guest.
Woohoo!
Janna Hines. Janna, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Hello. Well, first of all, I'm happy to be with you all. I am a diversity, equity, inclusion consultant, speaker, justice person on the internet. My background is in social work, so I always have come to conversations about race and diversity and all the things that make us, our identities, with just, a lens for looking at history and how it plays out in our world today. So that's a little bit about me and how I come to all this.
Yeah, so in full transparency, I think we all looked at each other and said, we really want to talk about In the Heat of the Night, but we are three pasty white people talking about this movie, and it might just be good to have another perspective in this conversation.
I wear 70 sunscreen, so just to give you how pasty I am.
My people were born on the side of a fjord, so that's where I come from. And, so Janna, thank you so much for joining us. I think you're going to add a very important perspective to a lot of what is going on in this movie, because this is a police procedural, but like, honestly, who cares? I mean, there's like so much else going on.
Yeah.
I have to say that I watched this movie for the first time, and there were several times where I gasped out loud, where I saw where they were going, who they were talking to, what the outcome of that was. And I was like, no, don't go there. And they went there. And, you know, I got to give them credit, because for 1967, it definitely was a pivotal movie in that sense, oh, yeah. I think.
Yeah. It was I kind of felt like it got progressively worse too as you watched the movie, the intensity of the hostility that was in the film. So like Eric said, today we are talking about In the Heat of the Night, 1967 film directed by Norman Jewison, screenplay by Sterling Siliphant.
Our boy from Side Mentor.
Sterling Siliphant. We wondered if he was real, but yes, he's real.
I mean, it does sound like a stage name.
It does. It sounds like a soap opera name. I will die on that hill.
And so he wrote the screenplay based on a novel by John Bale, A Ball. This movie did really well when it came to Oscar season there. Winner for Best Picture, Best Actor for Rod Steiger. Best screenplay based on material from another medium, which is a really weird.
Adapted is so much better.
Yeah.
How many other mediums did they have at that point? I don't.
I guess maybe a stage play. I don't know.
I have weird. Best sound and best film editing. It was also nominated for best director and best sound effects.
So a couple little bits of Oscar trivia that I learned that I thought were really interesting. Number one, Rod Steiger won Best Actor, as you just said. Same year, Katharine Hepburn won Best Actress for Guess Who's Coming to Dinner. So basically, these two white people who just kind of responded to essentially Sidney Poitier being in the room, both right. took home Oscars. Right. Sidney Poitier got nominated for Jack Shit this year. And this was also the year that he made To Sir with Love. And he got zero love from the Academy. I mean, he was already Oscar winner Sidney Poitier. He won his Oscar back in 1961. But come on, people. Like, do better.
I think that was probably the original, you know, hashtag Oscars so white before there was. Because even when I watched the film and I was thinking, I'm like, is this the one where he picked up the Academy Award? Mm-hmm. I didn't think this was it. And then when I saw the police chief got a win out of this, and that, I'm sorry, it did not register. Because in both of those movies, Katharine Hepburn, Rod Steiger, Sidney Poitier carries the movie. There is no movie without Sidney Poitier.
Absolutely.
And so I'm like, how did that happen? So
now, yeah, I will say, I liked Rod Steiger in this movie. I really, really did.
Yeah.
I'm not as like, you know, like, okay, fine. Katharine Hepburn, I was like, okay, you were barely, I mean, Spencer Tracy had a much better role in that movie than she did, you know, whatever. The other piece of Oscar trivia that I actually is a little bit more serious, and I couldn't believe I never heard this before. They had to postpone the 1968 Oscars because Martin Luther King was assassinated earlier that day.
That day?
Yes. So it was goodness. One of those things that, like, we cannot have a big, huge movie parade right now, you know, because maybe it wasn't that day, but it's time enough for the whole thing to be canceled and postponed. It was postponed to 2 days later, which makes me think that, yeah, it was probably that day.
That's, you know, like thoughts and prayers right there is 2 days.
So, well, but I mean, they took 2 days to kind of say, okay, we cannot have the Oscars today. So they had the Oscars 2 days later. And then on Oscar night, In the Heat of the Night, which was like one of Hollywood's best anti-racist vehicles ever, like one best picture 2 days after Dr. King was shot down in Memphis. I don't know. I just thought that was like that's a wild couple of days in American history.
It's like when they postponed the Emmys after 9/11. But I think it was only a few days. And then. Yeah.
Yeah. And then, folks, it's TV. So we have to like give out some, you know, funky ladies carrying big globes.
Speaking of globes, the Golden Globes.
Excellent segue. A+.
We are a team. Me and Matt.
A++.
The Golden Globes did show In the Heat of the Night some love as well. It was winner for Best Motion Picture Drama. Best Actor Drama, Rod Steiger, again, and then Best Screenplay. It was nominated for Best Director, for Best Actor Drama for Sidney Poitier, so he did get some recognition, although didn't get a win. And then Best Supporting Actress, Lee Grant. And then also Best Supporting Actress, Quentin Dean. So they were fighting each other for the best supporting actress.
Okay. Is there any contest between Lee Grant and Quentin Dean? I'm sorry. No.
Lee Grant is a queen.
Lee Grant it was amazing in this movie. And like, you know, the other, I mean, she didn't wear a bra. Okay. That's not a talent.
A talent, man, I'd be so rich. I wouldn't have to do this podcast, that's for sure.
It also won it was also nominated for a Grammy Award for Best Original Score, done by Quincy Jones.
I set out a little squeal when I saw his name in the credits. I was like, oh, it's gonna be right. An awesome score. I was like, yes, Quincy Jones.
It was too, it was a really good score.
And Ray Charles sang the theme song.
Yes, yeah. He did. Yeah. It is also number 75 on AFI's 100 Best Movies. And in 2002, it was selected for preservation in the United States National Film Registry by the Library of Congress as being culturally, historically, and aesthetically significant.
I think it's also on another AFI list for like best lines in movies. I think They Call Me Mr. Tibbs is like
number
somewhere.
16.
Okay, number 16.
Number 16.
Yeah.
I didn't know anything about the movie, but I did know that, and I did say it along with Sidney Poitier. I was like, yes.
The movie is about an African American Philadelphia homicide detective who is coerced into helping solve a murder case in a small town that is racially hostile in Mississippi after being lazily arrested for the crime itself.
How many people did they put under false arrest in this movie?
At least two, because they just didn't bother to look for
no
too many.
There was like
too many.
Three of them.
Virgil.
At least three. Virgil, Sam, Harvey,
and
their own police detective.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I mean, come on. These people are. It occurred to me watching this movie that like. All the white people in this movie are so incompetent at everything they do.
The Keystone Cops. That's all I could think of was like the Keystone Cops. That's what they were.
The only three people in this movie, literally, the only three who had any kind of competence whatsoever were Sidney Poitier.
Didn't live there.
The mechanic who like actually kept cars fucking running.
Right.
And the only person who was trusted enough to give medical care to women who needed reproductive health care, which is Bea Richards, the fifth queen of this podcast, by the way. Love her. I mean, it's like those are like the only kind of avatars of competence in this whole movie. Like everyone else is just idiotic.
ACAB.
So I guess racism makes you stupid. I mean, that's just, you know.
Well, and possibly Mrs. Colbert for insisting that Detective Tibbs stay and finish the case.
Right.
Yeah, I have some thoughts about
her. She recognized some incompetence going on there. spoiler warning, you know, I'm going to throw this out there. If you haven't watched the movie, pause, watch it, and then come back. This is a whodunit. And I kind of personally, I feel that not knowing who did it at the end, I was actually surprised for once. And it made the movie a little bit even more enjoyable. I mean, it's a rarity that I'm actually surprised. And I was kind of like, oh, wow, I did not see that coming. So,
yeah, this is an evergreen spoiler warning, by the way. We don't give a shit about spoilers. You had 55 years to watch this movie.
I am always surprised. And I was definitely like super surprised. I like to think of myself as a fairly intelligent individual, but I am, when I watch a whodunit, the dumbest, most gullible person on the face of the planet. I am almost never figure out who did it. So it's real fun for me to read like an Agatha Christie and be like, oh my God, what?
They all did it. Yeah.
Right. Or like a Knives Out. What? Yeah. Like I was
not surprised. I don't know. I was not a shocker for me. That guy was so obviously gross. Creepy and gross.
From the opening scene, I've heard this movie referenced throughout my life, just like you were saying around the "They Call Me Mr. Tibbs" and like all of those lines. Like I've heard it referenced, but this is the first time I sat through the whole movie, and so. Yeah, I did not see that coming until when I watched it. I was like, oh, okay, well, this makes sense because something seemed off. Why are you constantly trying to kill a fly on the wall and you work at a food establishment and it's just not.
Yeah, I just had this the second time we saw him, and we got a lot of him dancing around the diner alone, you know, and I was like, why are we spending so much time with this guy? And I didn't think like, oh, I bet he did it. But for whatever reason, when he came out of the, I mean, everyone remembers who he was.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, little piece of trivia. One of my favorite little, one of my favorite documentaries of all times is The Celluloid Closet. And they show this great scene from a movie called The Vanishing Point, where these two gay hitchhikers are picked up off the road and then forcibly ejected from the car as soon as our hero figures out that these are two queers. And it was just kind of an example of just how badly gay people could be treated in movies. The two gay hitchhikers are Ralph from this movie and the funeral director from this movie.
Stop it.
They were, they like, yes, 3 years later, they were cast in this movie together as the nameless gay hitchhikers who get forcibly ejected from a moving car because they're nasty queers. That's just, you know, that's where we are in history right now.
Wow.
That's a real pivot, a bigot to a gay, you know.
So oddly enough, I kind of thought Ralph might have been gay, and because he seemed like he was like awkwardly hitting on the police officer. So I was just like in a very odd way. And maybe that's just me.
I think he has resting lech face. I just think he's a lech no matter what. I think he just has, I think that's his face. He just mirrors at people.
You know that he tortured small animals as a child.
Oh,
like he was that, he's that type of person. Like I got that right away when he was like doing all that weird shit with that nasty looking pie. I was like, oh yeah, he definitely, that pie looks so nasty. You know, that's been sitting there for 5 days, that pie. Not unrefrigerated.
Yeah, not even Officer Wood wanted to get near that fucking pie.
Well, let's just jump into it then. Let's start talking about the cast.
Okay, let's do it.
Okay, so first off, the great Sidney Poitier as Detective Virgil Tibbs.
Is there anyone cooler in the history of the universe than Sidney Poitier? He is the coolest, just the coolest person. What do they say? The cool, as cool as the cool side of the pillow or the other side of the pillow or whatever that saying is. Yeah. I just think he just is just so chill.
Mm-hmm.
And I love to see everybody else riled up because he's so chill. Mm-hmm. That was the best part.
Well, it makes them more mad, you know, when he is. Mm-hmm. And here's a story that I have made up about Sidney Poitier. And I this comes from nowhere. And maybe I told it to myself or maybe I heard it somewhere. But nonetheless, I absolutely believe it to be true because I don't think his career would have been possible otherwise. I believe in my soul that he is one of those actors who was like, he turned down a lot of roles. I just know that he would not play anything that he felt was beneath his dignity. You know what I mean?
Yep.
I mean, is that true? Did I just make that up or?
Nope. Can confirm that is true. In a 2013 interview with, I want to say, CBS This Morning, and they were like reflecting on his career, and in the heat of the night, because he had a book coming out, he talked about that, how he took a lot of roles that he had to believe in the character, like in the the integrity, not like the character as in person, mm-hmm. but like their integrity, and wanted them to have a code of ethics, wanted them to exude this morality. And so in that interview, he talked about that because he actually got some flack from Black folks over it because all of his roles were kind of one-dimensional. And I don't mean that in a as an indictment to Sidney Poitier. I mean, if you're going to be the first Black person doing anything, you're carrying like the whole weight of the community mm-hmm. on your shoulders, right? And he knew the impact of representation. So he's like, well, if I'm the only one representing all of us, I want it to be the best possible image. Mm-hmm. But the flack from some Black folks came. There's an article, if you ever get a chance to read it, and it's called Why Do So Many White People Love Sidney Poitier? And it came out, I want to say in the, either in 69 or in the 70s. And they were talking about, like him being viewed as a docile Black man and all of these things and being perfect and how it wasn't a full image of Black folks' humanity. And so that's why a lot of Black folks were like, this isn't it. But at the same time, again, for me, I get it because that calmness and that coolness that you're talking about, when I think about my own life, I grew up in Northwest Arkansas. When we moved from predominantly Black, small rural town in Louisiana to Arkansas, and it was a more kind of affluent college town. It's Fayetteville, and I was the only Black kid in class. My family was the only Black family. And so there was a lot of pressure that comes with being that first anything, period, to not mess this up, to not that weight of representing all black people. And so on the one hand, Sidney Poitier knew that and was really, really intentional. And so he said that in the interview. The other thing that he said is about the slap. Sidney Poitier told them before he signed the contract, if Endicott slaps me, I am going to slap him back. And he said, you will put on paper. This is also in that 2013 interview, and it's really amazing to watch him say it and hear his voice saying it, where he says, you will put on paper that this film won't be shown anywhere in the world with me just standing here and taking the slap. And the next line he said, it gave me chills when I was watching it. I watched it last night. He said, I knew it would be an insult to black people all over the world if I just stood there and took the slap. And I was just like, whew, because it did. And also, like, it's a quick slap. But at the same time, it's this moment of kind of release for me when I was watching it, because the whole film up until that point is just eye rolls and woo, can you believe this shit? And just like insane amounts of racism. He's been like, there's been a false arrest, all this stuff. And so to me, when that happens, it is kind of Sidney Poitier, again, knowing the power of representation. He was the first black person to slap a white person on film in 1967, the year before they murdered Dr. King. It is massive. Like I have so much respect and awe for that, and for having that put into his contract before he said yes. So anyway, there are some other things that Sidney Poitier did that were just very badass to me with his own boundaries. Because in the movie, I'm like, Virgil needs boundaries. I'm sorry. I would have been left. I would have been left. You arrest me. Bye. Solve your own murder.
I mean, part of me is thinking like the worst villain in this whole movie is the, you know, the other end of the phone when his Philadelphia police chief says, hey, why don't you stick around this like really dangerous town in the deep south and help them solve a murder? Like
that part.
Yes. You know, it's like anybody like a good boss would have said, get your ass back to Philadelphia.
Right. I will come get you. I'm on my way to come get you. No, that would have been, and me and my husband, we watched it together, and I was like, it would have been credits as soon as my chief on the phone was like, yeah, Janna works here. And I'm like, all right, bye. And then just the back and forth of, oh, they wouldn't accept my help. No, I'm sorry. There are just so many things that crack me up. Also in terms of in real life, that's kind of what, when I was watching with my husband, we were like, real black people wouldn't do that. Like, I'm sorry. Real black people would not be on a train to Mississippi at 4 a.m. I'm sorry. You're going to catch me at daylight. I grew up around Mississippi. I grew up in Lake Providence, Louisiana. It is an hour away from Jackson, Mississippi. My father has a motto. It is don't drive to Mississippi at night. And sadly, it still rings true in 2022.
Oh, yeah.
So that part of him being there at 4 a.m, I'm like, that wouldn't happen. This whole, I'm staying around, that wouldn't happen. So it's just hilarious to see the links that we had to go through to get the film.
It's a lot of suspension of disbelief.
Oh, yeah.
But let me tell you, when he slapped Endicott, the gasp and the excitement that I let out, I'm sure they heard it next door at the apartment next door, because I was like, fuck yes, Sidney Poitier. Like,
but in a way, Janna, like, what you say, it's interesting. It's like, you know, on the one hand, he got a lot of flack for being, quote unquote, too perfect. But on the other hand, his face after that slap, I mean, this was like one of the best depictions of rage I have ever seen. I mean, he controlled it. He only slapped him once. He didn't beat him down. He didn't do he didn't go Tarantino on the guy. But, you know, he was pissed. And very controlled, and more controlled, as you say, than a lot of people would be in that same situation. But it's not that he just played this angel who just polished his halo the whole time. Like, he was real, real mad. And the other thing that kind of I was thinking about this movie, my favorite scene, I think, in the whole movie is when Gillespie goes to the train station to ask him nicely to stay. Because the very first thing Tibbs says is, no. I'm not staying. Like, fuck you. I'm not staying.
Yeah.
And one of the, like, I love all these tropes. Like, I don't love them. I hate most of them, but I like paying attention to kind of these. And Spike Lee refers to, like, the magical Negro trope, like the black man who basically exists to help out all the white characters.
Yep.
And I'm like, that was not this. They sidestepped that trope rather nicely in this movie by having Poitier be like, I'm staying on my own terms. And I kind of like the fact that Rod Steiger was like, you can't stand it. You just want to show the whole world how much smarter you are than all us stupid rednecks. And I'm like, yeah, and I do too. Like, at that point, I was like, okay, I wanted Tibbs to get out, but now I kind of want him to stay because I want him to solve this crime and show all these assholes like what real police work looks like. You know what I mean? So
there was a time in my life where I did want to prove racist wrong. Like, there was a time in my life, when, even as like a diversity, equity, inclusion consultant and practitioner, where I was like, oh, if I can just prove these people wrong or just make them see like what how great I am. And it breeds a lot of, honestly, a lot of perfectionism, a lot of anxiety. So it's both. 'Cause it's, on the one hand, it's yes, like that is clearly a part of Virgil Tibbs' motive. It's like, yeah, I do want to show you guys off. And I think that's very human. But also at the same time, I think of people like Malcolm X during that time who were like, no, I'm not going back and forth with you all. Like, if you choose to be racist, I have nothing to prove to you. I have nothing to say to you. That is what it is. I'm not going to exude my intelligence, my expertise for the sake of proving you wrong when you already are in the wrong. I'm not here for that. And so it's both of those for me when I think about this movie.
But I think it's kind of a stick in the eye to his critics though, right, too, because Tibbs was human. He fell victim to a little bit of his own hubris because he knew he was the smartest person in the room. You know, if he had been the perfect character that all of his critics said he always played, he would have gotten on that fucking train.
Yeah.
You know, he would have.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I hear that. I hear that. I think one of the other things, when you brought up Gillespie and Tibbs at the train, one of my favorite lines, more than the "they call me Mr. Tibbs," like, even though everybody quotes that line, is what Sidney Poitier says to Rod Steiger as they're sitting there when he's trying to convince him and saying that that there are jobs that were going to come as a result of the factory. And he's like, half of these jobs are going to go to colored people, your people. And Poitier goes, no, these are your people. As in, you are the chief of police. You are supposed to protect and serve this entire community. I don't live here. I live in Philadelphia. These are your people. And what I love about that line is he's calling out what's wrong. You don't see them as your people.
Mm-hmm.
And you are the chief of police for this entire community. You're charged with protecting and serving this community. I don't live in this community. They're not my people. Like, yes, we are all black people, but you don't see them as belonging to your community. And that's the problem. So that's my favorite line, is that moment on the train when he says that.
I mean, we could just have a whole podcast just about Sidney Poitier, I think. The levels.
Truly. I know there are other cast members, but before I move on from Sidney Poitier, another moment of, again, this movie would not have been made without this man, which is why it hurts me that he did not receive an Oscar nomination for his work. So he said, I will slap this man back, point blank period, put that in paper. But the other thing is, he refused to film this movie south of the Mason-Dixon line.
Mm-hmm.
And that, get that, I love it, because I think, again, while we're watching Tibbs and his own boundaries, and he starts doing things on his own terms, I love that Sidney Poitier had those boundaries and was like, listen, Harry Belafonte and I got into a situation in Mississippi. I'm not actually filming this thing in Mississippi. If y'all want me in this movie, we're going to film it in Illinois. Thanks. Like, that also, I love his advocacy in every way. So that was the last little Sidney Poitier tidbit from me.
But then I read that they did have to go to Tennessee to film the cotton fields because they didn't have any in Illinois. Mm-hmm. And they got death threats. In the 3 days they were down there, he got death threats. And he said he slept with a gun under his pillow.
Mm-hmm. Jesus.
So, like, this is the world he was living in. I mean, it anyone who listens to this show knows how much I hate it when people talk about actors and go, oh, that's so brave. This was actually, like, he risked his life, you know, for his art, like, literally. I mean, this was a brave man.
Yeah.
Not because he said certain lines or he played certain characters or, you know, usually that's so brave comes around when someone plays somebody who's gay or trans. Like, oh, that's so brave. And I'm like, oh, fuck off. But, like, right. You could actually use that word to describe Poitier, and it fits.
Right.
Next up on the cast list is Rod Steiger as Chief Bill Gillespie.
Can I just say, before we start talking about him, is that the affectation of the gum made me want to punch him in the face. I mean, I wanted to punch him in the face anyway for a variety of reasons.
It was too much.
I just, the gum, in my old age.
No one chews gum that fast.
In my old age, just that sort of chewing gum situation is just like, it's like misphonia for me. I don't know what it is. It drives me up a wall. Too much gum.
That was the director's suggestion to him. And he at first didn't want to do it, but he ended up really enjoying the affectation. So he went through a heck of a lot of gum, 263 packs of gum.
He was very good. He was very good. Yes. I'm actually not going to take his Oscar away from him. I think that Poitier absolutely should have been nominated. That is a crime against humanity. He did a good job. I mean, it was one of those things that what I appreciated about this is that it wasn't the redemption arc that his character goes on was believable. Mm-hmm. I mean, the most Tibbs got out of Chief Gillespie in this whole movie is take care. You hear? That's it. Like, it wasn't as though he like became like, you know, the head of the Sparta, Mississippi NAACP, like white ally of the year. Like, it didn't go to that kind of, you know what I mean?
Ally of the year.
But you know what I mean? I mean, it just, but he was humbled in that he had to learn, you know, that this man knew what he was doing and developed a grudging respect for someone that he treated like shit at the beginning of this movie. And he kind of, you know, and he went there and, you know, I thought it was, and I also thought it was, I thought his character was really well written in that when you meet him, he's just the old racist sheriff. And you don't find out like till the end of the, well, you kind of get these hints. Like at one point, the mayor says to him, like, our old sheriff would have done it this way. Mm-hmm. And you're like, okay, there's something going on there. And then you find out at the very end of the movie, he's new in town. Nobody likes him. You know, he's not the most, he's lonely. He's not very, you know, and that's, he's not very respected throughout the town, even for being the sheriff. The mayor pushes him around. Like, he's not, he's in this kind of state of, he's not as in control as you might have thought at the beginning. And that does feed into one of my theories about people who are the worst when it comes to all the isms of our society, is that they are fundamentally not happy and incomplete. Because that's what causes, I mean, a lot of it is just learned. So yes, a lot of that is structural and societal. But the people who are the absolute worst, people who get obsessed on hating other groups of people just because of their identity, they are somehow broken. That was well done. And I thought that he did a great job. I thought these two actors were, and I will say he gets points for, in his Oscar acceptance speech, basically laid it at the feet of Sidney Poitier and said, had I not been acting across the table from this man, this performance would not have been nearly what it was.
But I thought it was interesting, though, that we learn enough of his backstory for it to be able to sort of see where he comes from. But I was kind of curious, like, where did he come from? Like, where was he working before? Is he from the South? You know, like, I don't know. So that's good, because normally I'm not that interested in my character, in the characters, but to be honest, but I was interested in his backstory, a little bit more of his backstory.
Something that just came up for me in watching the chief, Chief Gillespie, is similar to Eric, what you were saying about, you know, how seeing people who really live into all of the isms of discrimination, hate, prejudice, bigotry, racism, homophobia, all of it, like, that, you know, there's something fundamentally wrong. I think for me, it's just, it comes down to power and control. Mm-hmm. And just that, in that sense of, Toni Morrison used to say, you know, like, if I take your race away, if you can only be big if someone else is small, what is that? Like, what is that worth, you mm-hmm. know? And so I think for me, when I'm watching it, it's really just him and even the fact that Sam Wood, who was very questionable, which we're going to get to his character in a little bit, but very questionable as a human being, feels this sense of, again, entitlement and empowerment when he's bringing Tibbs in and when they're talking to him. And it's about that power of, and it's like everybody is wanting to remind Tibbs, like, we have power over you. And it was, for me, when I looked at the chief, he was saying, I have extra power over you because I am the law. I am law enforcement. And so I definitely, during the scene where they're trying to showcase some more of his humanity, right? And he's drinking the bourbon. He's like, you know, if anything cures insomnia. And Sidney's like, no, bourbon doesn't. And he's drinking and talking about he's lonely, doesn't have wives and have kids. And it was this moment of humanity, right? Where he's saying, this is what I'm going through. Mm-hmm. And then Sidney Poitier tries to empathize with this man and says, I don't get any lonelier than you. And he says, don't get smart, black boy. I almost turned the TV off. I was like, are you kidding me?
Right.
But that's the thing of when you let go of power and you lean into humility, then he in that moment, it's like he didn't want to be equals with Sidney Poitier. He mm-hmm. didn't want to say that that I'm feeling the same loneliness that you feel, because that's really what all of these isms are about, is some sense of I'm better than you, either because of my whiteness or my straightness or my cisgenderedness or my abilities. I want to be better than you, because that to me is what it comes down to. Because if it's about connection or about something being missing, then it'd be like, oh wow, you feel lonely too. But it's like, wait a second, I can't be as lonely as this black man. Like, it's just like, wait. It's the relinquishing of power that scared him. So mm-hmm. that's what kind of comes up for me when I think about the chief and his progression.
But their hold on power is so tenuous, right? I mean, like when the mayor can boss you around, and when you can't even get the creepy diner guy to call you Officer Wood, and he insists on calling you Sam like you're a fucking mm-hmm. civilian. Yeah, mm-hmm. that's why they latch onto these displays of power. It's like right after being yeah. humiliated by the diner guy, he goes straight to the train station and starts abusing, you know, Sidney fucking Poitier because he can.
You know, it's yep. interesting that you point to the scene inside Gillespie's house, because that just proves how good the two of them are as actors, because that scene was actually mostly improvised. That was the two of them coming up with dialogue.
Wow.
Huh. Yeah, so they understood their characters that well.
Wow,
yeah.
that is amazing to know. I did not know that. Wow.
And Rod Steiger, he's also like Carol O'Connor, who played Chief Bill Gillespie in the TV show In the Heat of the Night. I don't know if anyone remembers that from the 80s.
I do.
You know, both of them were these like big, you know, white haired, kind of fat white guys who looked like your stereotypical awful bigot, but were actually both really super liberal and, you know, progressive minded in their own personal lives. I mean, you know, Carol O'Connor, we all think about Archie Bunker. And of course, he was like the polar opposite of Archie Bunker in his life. So, you know, I also think that was kind of cool. I mean, Rod Steiger knew the movie he was making, and he knew how shocking this whole thing would be. You know, and he sat there and watched Sidney Poitier slap the shit out of that plantation owner and went, yep, I like being in this movie.
Well, since we've already talked about him, let's move on to Officer Sam Wood, played by Warren Oates.
Small dick energy. That's all I have to say about that man.
He's got some parts that are going on for me, but it was nothing as integral. You could have put anybody in that role and it really would not have affected the movie, in my opinion. So I could take or leave Warren Oates. I don't feel like the performance was
really. I don't know. I mean, I think it takes some amount of talent and self-awareness to play someone who's so obviously slappable. Like you have to be
a punchable face.
Yes, you know what I mean. I mean, he knew that what he had to get across was an audience, even an audience of people who hold very strong racial biases, who would normally be on his, like, they have to hate me, you know? And so he had all of those ticks that just made him unlikable. And I thought that for what it's worth, he did that pretty well.
Yeah, he did do that. He did do that. No, I think he as a character just irked me from the beginning.
Oh, yeah.
Just irked, but not to the same level as, I know we'll get to him later, getting to Ralph. But it was, like you said, it's not easy to be the guy that literally everybody hates, mm-hmm. but everybody hated Sam Wood.
Yep.
Even yes. people who shared the same values as him were not fans.
Yeah.
So yeah, he did his job.
His boss arrested him for murder. I mean, like, That's leadership 101. Maybe don't arrest your employee for murder unless you're pretty damn sure they did it.
Right.
And I love how his brothers in blue like didn't even bat an eyelash. They were like, all right, Sam, come on back to the jail. They were like, we're going to go this way. You know where it is.
You know where it
they
is.
Were like, hey, you arrested our boy. Like, no, they were like, well, this could be possible.
Yeah.
Yeah. He didn't even make it out of jail because he got sent there for something else anyways later. So. We can all cheer for that. Next up is Mrs. Colbert, played by Lee Grant.
Queen Lee Grant.
Love her.
I went, you know, as I've said many times in this podcast, if I'm watching this on Amazon Prime, I always do the X-ray. So I'll stop it and I'll look to see who it is. And then I'll read their bio. Some of the bios are actually really funny. You can tell that they wrote them versus like a publicist. but I had forgotten that Lee Grant was caught up in the House on American Committee, uh-huh. accused of being a communist. And so basically she had 10 years where she did not act at all.
This was her first movie back. After the Blacklist.
Wow.
Yeah, this was the first thing she did. Did anyone else have a reaction, though, when you've in her very first scene and Virgil Tibbs goes in there and he's like, I'm going to tell her, because I guess his thought was she deserves to know, you know, mm-hmm. especially when she has that whole speech. When he shut the door, I was like, oh, shit. This is not going to go well.
It's a Kill a Mockingbird moment. Like
you're in Mississippi, dude. You do not want to be in a room all alone with a white woman. Like I was.
And a distraught then, white woman.
And then, I mean.
Crying.
And so like, yes, I hear what you say, Matt, when things get worse and worse and worse. But this was actually kind of an oddly pleasant surprise that this actually, all that tension I was feeling. And it was like, oh, okay. She's not going to, you know, go on a rampage because a black man touched her in a room all alone. But I mean, it could have gone there. And that was a little of me going, Tibbs, like, seriously, like, do you know where you are?
No, I filed that under things real black people would not do. I'm serious. I filed that under things real black people would not do because. Nope. There's an episode. It reminded me of this is off topic, but there's an episode of Blackish where Dre, there's a white baby in an elevator as he's pressing the button to open the elevator and the doors, and he sees like this white baby just looking up, and he looks around and then he runs away. And then his wife and his kids are like, what is wrong with you? You're a monster. And then his dad comes and he's like, what are y'all yelling about? And he's like, there was a white baby by itself in the elevator. He's like, got to be more careful. And it just cracked me up. Like, I'm just like, no, I'm not taking any chances. So yeah, that scene, that was one I raised my eyebrow at vividly. Because I was just like, this would not happen. This is 12 years after Emmett Till.
Yeah.
That is fresh on everyone's mind. No. I'm like, I will offer you my condolences from the lobby, sis. I'm not, I will shout, he's dead. He's dead. Like, I'll shout it back there, but.
Through the window.
No.
Yeah, and I hear what you're saying, Matt, about Mrs. Colbert. I always think Colbert now because of Stephen, but that's probably wrong. About her kind of having the foresight to know, like, you know, we need to keep this man on the case, and she does that. It was a little like, are we having another Kevin Costner in Hidden Figures kind of moment where this white person kind of swoops in and saves the day? But I thought it worked in this movie because mostly what she noticed when they were going back and forth about whether or not Harvey could have possibly killed this man is that Sidney Poitier was the only detective who knew what the fuck he was doing. And all of the other policemen there were insisting that this guy Harvey did it, not because it's likely, but just because of their pride. And so here she was thinking, I'm a woman who just found out that my husband was murdered, and I want to find out who fucking did it. And that's where she was coming from. So it was not, she was not making a stand for racial justice in that moment. She was wanting to find out who the hell killed her husband. And
yeah,
that
she was
really
selfish.
I mean, and not selfish, but I mean, she had agency. She had her own reasons. She wasn't like this avatar of tolerance and purity and like moral goodness. Because I think that's the problem with most of these movies. And this movie like did not let white people off the hook, which is what I really liked about it. Because had they written this character to be more, oh, I see beyond race and he's brilliant and I just like him. No, everyone has said, oh, I'm her. No, you're not. But you could say that maybe you would have been her in that instance because she just really wanted to find out who the hell killed her husband. And that seemed real.
Well, and honestly, she had a lot of disdain for the town. She did not want to be there.
No.
She was dragged there by her husband. Yeah.
Yeah. And she's a rich lady from Chicago who lives.
Right.
She has a view of the river from her private terrace and her high-rise apartment. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So she knew what was what, and she knew that the police officers there were way out of their league. And, like, they just could not handle this case. So she wanted somebody that seemed capable. And Virgil Tibbs was standing there, and he's like, okay, well, he at least is talking correctly. So, you know, he knows what he's talking about. So let's
but just to give you an idea of just how powerless, going back to Rod Steiger, felt for just a moment, like, the widow of the victim is dictating to him who's going to be on his team. Like, that's how little power this supposedly big, tough sheriff has in this town, you know? And awesome. Like, that was great. Like, you got the power, girl, you wield it, because these people are full of shit.
Yeah.
And incompetent.
Yeah.
next up is Scott Wilson as Harvey Oberst,
who you all might know as Herschel Green from Walking Dead.
Yeah. Okay.
Right? It's the eyes. Well, so again, X-ray, love it. Shout out to Amazon Prime, sponsor us. I clicked on it and I was reading through and I was like, he looks really familiar in that picture that they're using. And I was like, holy shit. Yeah.
I don't watch The Walking Dead, but he was also the lead in something that we've discussed already today, In Cold Blood, made the exact same year on the recommendation of Sidney Poitier. They did that scene in the jail cell, and Poitier was like, this guy is a really good actor. And he called the director for In Cold Blood and said, I found someone you should read for the. So he played the lead in Cold Blood based on a phone call from Sidney Poitier, and apparently didn't find out about that until after he got the role. It was like, by the way, you know, you should send Mr. Poitier a thank you card.
Yeah, some cigars. Some Cubans.
I really liked Harvey. I mean, as an incidental character, that scene between him and Sidney Poitier in the jail cell, mm-hmm. there was a very tender moment there that seemed very honest and real. And I really enjoyed that. Was actually one of my favorite scenes in the movie, because you don't really know Harvey. I guess Harvey seemed the least racist out of all the people. Is that a thing? I mean, can I don't know if that's a thing.
Yikes, what a scale.
At least he seemed able to have an honest conversation and put something aside and, you know, inside that moment. And I think, you know, Virgil seemed to connect with him too. I mean, that's, you know, the thing that I really loved about this movie is that Virgil is constantly having to be the better person, and he's finding a way to do it. And I know we just already talked about it, but there's something so real about all of his interactions and finding the smart way to connect with people to get what he needs. You know, whether he's arguing with them and throwing it in their face, or having that tender moment and trying to make a connection with them that way. I thought everything that he did was, like, fantastic. And that was one of my favorite scenes.
Yeah, I think Harvey came around for me at the end with the cheeseburger, whatever. He was like,
yes,
like,
that's the scene.
Do you want onions? Yeah, he's like, no, you're talking. But I think going back to what you said about Sidney Poitier having to be the better person and be the bigger person, I'm very cognizant of how many times I say as a black woman, because sometimes I say it every day for every sentence. It's just like it's just constantly applicable. But legitimately, as a black woman, when I think about, like, that, those scenes of this man, him coming in a jail cell and this man saying, why are you wearing the white man's clothes? Because Sidney Poitier is wearing a suit, and like all of these interactions, and like the mental gymnastics that it takes to endure overt racism, mm-hmm. and somehow find a connection point with an individual who honestly is not in the least bit interested in connecting with you, though it is in their best interest to listen to you, it's exhausting. Like, honestly, by the time I got done watching this movie, I was like, why the hell am I so tired? And I was like, whoa, that, like, it's because it's the mental gymnastics, right? Of like, yeah, I know you're going to be racist as hell, but like, let me try to get to this connection point with you. Let me try to find the thing that you'll listen to. No, that again was the time. And I think going back to what Eric said around the time of this movement and the movie, Dr. King is there. Like, that's kind of the example that a lot of people are looking to. Mm-hmm. And I saw Sidney Poitier emulating that a lot. And also Dr. King got flack for it too, because there are people being like, I don't want to be docile. I don't want to be nonviolent. I'm not with that. But at the same time, again, it speaks to the times they were in, because here's Harvey being overtly racist, horrifically racist, and then he's saying, I'm on your side, bud. I want to help you get out of jail. It is it's wild, but it's also just, yeah, it's mentally exhausting. It just speaks to the experience of being Black in America and knowing that you have to be 10 steps ahead, 10 times better, and holding space for other people's humanity, but them not holding space for your own. So that's what came up for me watching that part.
It's true.
Let's talk Bayard Richards then as Mama Celeb.
Oh my God. She was like, okay, so first of all, everyone needs to go to HBO Max if you have it right now and watch Bea, A Black Woman Speaks, which is an hour and a half long documentary about her life and her career. She was an activist. She was a poet. She was a playwright. She was an actress. She's amazing. And she was nominated for an Oscar this year for her role in Guess Who's Coming to Dinner as Sidney Poitier's mother. Mother. That's just a whole thing about how Hollywood is so fucking weird about gender and age and all that kind of, but whatever. Yeah. But she was also brilliant in that movie too. She and Sidney were both in both movies.
I've never seen Guess Who's Coming to Dinner. I know. I will. But it's interesting that you say that, because I did feel like they had a real connection acting beside each other. And so I don't know in which order the movies were shot, but you could see that they already had a real rapport. And I just thought that was because they were two amazing actors, but it seems that they had a little bit of a connection too, which I liked.
Yeah. I found that I enjoyed her scene because she said what I was thinking throughout the movie.
She was your proxy.
she was my proxy, where, When Sidney Poitier says, like, oh, like, I'm working with the police to solve this murder. And she was like, they're going to take your soul. I was like, please, ma'am, please tell him that this is not the move. but just, I think in that moment, she's the only other, besides the mechanic, the only other Black voice we hear, you know? And just to see, again, their perspectives on the situation and her realizing, I can't remember exactly how she says the line of trying to keep everything that she's earned and not being separated from it, and you're not going to take it from me. There's no way I thought about that if the chief would have come, if he would have been the one to come and try to, like, to say all of that, right? To say that I'm going to help keep your business. I'm going to make sure that nothing happens to you. I don't think it would have gone that way. I don't think there would have been any type of conversation like that. But primarily, I love her for saying what I was thinking in Sidney Poitier's role.
I was kind of surprised in that moment when she started talking about that, about, you know, they're going to steal your soul. But it was a really true statement, which is kind of, especially because of this police department is essentially just using him. They're not really friends of him. They're, for most of the people there, don't respect him, although he's getting a begrudging respect out of Bill Gillespie throughout the movie. I mean, I don't know if Bill is going to make a full recovery for being a racist, but I mean, I think he's getting there. But it's interesting to actually see.
Well, when you make three false arrests in a row and then one guy like finds the real murderer, it's kind of hard to kind of ignore that data to say, yeah, this guy's a better detective than I am. I mean,
yeah. Well, and he, as the movie goes on, he more quickly says, okay, he agrees with whatever Virgil is saying. He'll, you know, and towards the end, he is actually trying to protect Virgil from himself, where he doesn't want Virgil to go into areas where he knows Virgil is just endangering himself. So there is a progression in that. And who knows if he's doing it to just prevent another.
Yes, and at the same time, he also doesn't want a cop killed in his town because that's just more shit. You know, he doesn't want Philadelphia coming down and finding out what a bunch of ragtag morons they all are.
True enough, too. So since we're talking about racists, why don't we go back and talk about Eric Endicott, played by Larry Gates.
Slappable.
I mean, I don't have a lot to say about him, except I will say that my veins filled with ice when I saw that they were driving up to the cotton plantation and through the cotton plantation. And I was like, oh, fuck. Like, what's going to happen? Like, yeah.
That was, I think I could have done without the lawn jockey on the very front as we were walking.
Oh, no. I thought that was brilliant. I knew exactly where I was. Yeah. Did you not know exactly where you were as soon as you saw that fucking lawn jockey in the front door?
Yeah, I mean, even before. But I also thought it was interesting to see the juxtaposition of Virgil helping the white police and the sharecroppers kind of looking at him in that car going up to the plantation. All of that whole scene from beginning to end was really very, it was eye-opening, obviously, but I thought about it a lot. It was probably, for me, the most, the dichotomy that I had in my head. That whole scene was really kind of interesting and shocking, really, you know.
The scene itself, the superiority that he just kind of exuded the entire time he was there. He treated Virgil as if he was one of the people that just worked on his plantation. He absolutely gave him no respect.
Those are the only black people he knows.
Yeah. The
Negro needs care and compassion. Oh my God.
Brings us back to the slap, which I am so glad he had, because then it escalates even more, because he looks to the sheriff and said, the last sheriff would have shot him. What are you going to do? And that just really, that right there codifies the city that they're in, like the state of affairs right there.
But how much did you love his black butler who just gave him the eye roll and the shake of the head on the way out of the, like, there was... you know what? I was just like, yeah, you have just been brought down so low that even one of your own servants is going to look at you like, dude, you're
pathetic.
So
let's talk about that for a second, because I couldn't tell if the eye roll was for Sidney Poitier, for Virgil, or for the Eric Endicott.
I thought it could have gone both ways.
Yeah.
Thought it could have gone both ways, because on the one hand, if I'm that butler and I have to live here and work here, I would be rolling my eyes and shaking my head, because it's like, well, my life just got harder. this guy just came in here. I don't know what the term would be. My boss is overtly racist. I don't know what's going to happen to me now as a result of him coming in and doing that. So that was one way I took it, and another way I took it was the first way of just being like, wow, Endicott really, really is not a smart person. So
I would have thought that if it was the first, that man would have kept his eyes on his shoes, and he would have gotten out of that room as soon as possible. The fact that he even looked at him and then just kind of gave him this shake of the head like, dude, you are, you know. And what I loved about Larry Gates's performance was that just that look on his face, like he's just going to break into tears because he doesn't know what else to do. I mean, when you kind of layer masculinity onto this whole thing, right? The idea that he has to go to he said, you know, Gillespie, did you see that? Well, what are you going to do about it? And Gillespie says, I don't know. And he was just like, there was a time I could have had you shot, but he's utterly powerless. And that's the whole thing you were talking about before, Janet. It's all about power, right? In that moment, Endicott had no power. He's got all the money in the world. He can buy and sell anybody in that fucking town. But you know what? It's 1967, and yes, it was shocking, but a black man just slapped him across the face, who also happens to be a police officer, and there is nothing he could do about it. And I understand that when that moment happened in 1967, like, audiences just went, you know, I mean, there was no air in the room. People had such a reaction to that moment. I will say that in my own 2022 lens, I also can't believe that anybody just walked up to a cop and slapped him across the face. Like, both of those things. And I think that's where Tibbs was, too. He was like, it was an instantaneous reaction to slap that man back. That was not something that he thought through, right? And if he'd thought through it, he might not have done it. But it was just like, I am a police officer, and I'm doing my job. You don't get to just walk up and slap me across. No. And so it was this instantaneous boom, got slapped right back. And maybe in that moment he was like, maybe I shouldn't have done that, but he was too pissed to care. And the rage just below the level of his eyes was just, oh, it was brilliant. It was such a great moment.
I mean, so slapping a police officer is an arrestable offense.
Oh, totally.
It's assaulting a police officer.
Even so, then.
Although,
I mean, Endicott had never met a black police officer in his entire life, but they existed, and he just committed a felony. And so it was up to Gillespie to do something about it, and Gillespie was like, uh-uh.
Gillespie did what Virgil should have done at the beginning.
No, I'm okay.
Yeah, I'm good.
I'm good on this one.
I don't have a dog in this fight. Yeah,
I'm going to take my yellow sunglasses and we're going to go.
Not the yellow sunglasses. That was a very interesting fashion choice, which I can't believe we're just now talking about that. It's character time. The one thing I was going to say about the scene with Endicott and Larry Gates's performance that stood out to me. When I think about the conversation with Endicott and how he's trying to exude this intelligence and sophistication of, oh, you like orchids, and like, oh, like, did you know this little fact about, and it made me think of just some of the ways that we still see this almost academic tone to justifying racism or justifying all of the different isms, right? But especially back then, there were comments that were made around the size of black people's skulls and like all of these different things to try to justify it and make it sound academic. And so that, to me, was what I appreciated about the performance, is that he wasn't like, now I'm from Mississippi, you're going to go down there, you're not going to tell me how to run my town. See, like, it was the astute racist. Like, that was what I appreciated, because that's, in my opinion, my vantage point, it's that sophisticated level of racism, those dog whistles, whatever. I mean, he got overt by the end, but that that veil of intelligence and sophistication is what gets people that far in being able to control cities and towns and things like that.
Well, the other interesting thing about that scene to me, based on like kind of like dovetailing into what you were just saying, is that I wasn't expecting it, because he started off just talking very, you know, intelligently about flowers and stuff. And then as they start to talk about the orchids themselves, it just slips in there and you're like, wait a minute, what did he just say? Wait, what? Oh,
yeah.
Oh, no, he is just flat out racist. Okay, so let's just move on.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's the same thing.
How quickly we forget about the lawn jockey, Matt.
Context clues,
yeah. I mean, it's that racism with a smile, right? It's still racism. And I think it's, again, it's the same things we see now, that there are people who hold a lot of degrees, a lot of letters behind their name, and yet still believe this stuff, whether it's like believing that black people are inferior in some way biologically, or whether it's believing that they shouldn't have equal access to voting rights. There are still people with that veil of intelligence or academia or whatever it is, and that allows them to have a platform, have access. And so it was just funny seeing it, that for Endicott, it's within this town in his cotton industry in this greenhouse. But I think about, you could name drop several elected officials, like people who are prominent in culture, that it's the same thing, right? Yeah. So, yeah, that was an interesting scene.
Lastly, we have
Creepy McCreeperson.
Anthony James as Ralph Henshaw.
What a shock. He looked so innocent the entire time.
I'm still going to say I was surprised when he appeared out of the shadows, because I just didn't see his character as being that important. He was just weird.
Well, it was the timing was weird. I mean, you know, how far did he have to get to? Well, I guess he killed him earlier in the night, I guess, is what we're supposed to believe, right? He killed Colbert long before he was trying to like shoot flies with rubber bands at the diner in the very first scene.
Because he said he got a ride to the diner.
Yeah.
So, but I mean, I was surprised. I was kind of also disappointed. I don't know who I expected to walk out of the shadows, but I was like, oh, him?
Right.
I don't know. I felt like, you know, like they were trying to make Fetch happen. Like they were trying to make Ralph happen. And I just, I don't know. It felt a little toothless to me. I don't know.
I mean, honestly, we were out of suspects.
We were out of
I mean, unless Dolores was impregnated by her own brother, which would have been a whole other Flowers in the Attic kind of situation.
The weird thing you say about that, I kind of thought that's who that was in the shadows, was Mr. Purdy.
Because she had that moment where she was like, and my brother left me all alone. Like, and so that's, she was justifying why she dances around naked in front of the window. And I was like, oh, she had a thing for her brother. Like, is that what's going on? And so that's what I was tracking with too at first, was like, it's going to be the brother. And this is very uncomfortable. Or before that, the other thought that for me would have made it more interesting, because I agree, I was a little bit disappointed that it was Ralph. I was kind of like, oh.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I guess it's kind of like, cool. Shoulder shrug. Okay, all right. Like, this seems like this would be in your wheelhouse. I don't know. Like, it doesn't really, the motive doesn't seem as compelling to me. So at first, what I kind of thought would be the case was that maybe Colbert, I'm not sure I'm pronouncing his name correctly, but that maybe he had a relationship with Dolores and that she had killed him as an act of vengeance and not wanting to be on the side.
Or maybe the brother killed him to protect his
Yes. And so that's where I was going at first. So I too was a little bit let down by Ralph being the person. So, yeah.
Yeah, Ralph.
To me, watching the movie, it seemed to progress worse and worse and worse. Was that just me, or did anybody else have that effect? I mean, in the film, that it just seemed to get worse and worse and worse.
Well, it's just sort of like the town grapevine. Like, oh, here's this uppity black person in our town. And then, you know, they hear about it. The mob grows more and more. I mean, that's how it kind of works. So that's how I saw it.
Yeah, the mob at the four guys who were chasing him, who I assume were sent after him by Endicott. That was my thought. They weren't just weren't just like, you know, see a black man driving along and decide to commit a hate crime. I mean, I think that they were sent after him because of that. So that's one of the reasons why. But honestly, the scariest moment for me, and probably the whole movie, is when Wood meets Tibbs at the train depot. And without saying so much as a hello, has got him, you know, legs spread, hands on the wall, and that just that shot of Sidney Poitier's face going, holy shit, I should have listened to my mother and taken the day train, right? I mean, that was just like, you know, that to me was probably even scarier than, because I honestly did not know what was going to happen.
Yeah.
Because we've all seen this story before in 2022. Like, we just know that interactions between black men and white police officers often don't go well. And we kind of have an idea that in Mississippi in the late 60s, it might even be a little worse.
Just a tad.
I would have imagined.
just a smidge worse.
We say worse, but how much worse does it get from George Floyd? I mean, you know, same thing.
I mean, yeah. I mean, there's a lot of parallels. I mean, I do think about in Mississippi, like I said, you know, Emmett Till had happened 12 years before that, murdered, drowned, body thrown in the ocean. His mother has an open casket funeral to say, this is how racist this country is, that they would do this to my son. I mean, yeah, Mississippi is known for a distinct level of brutality when it comes to racial violence. So I hear that. I think one of the things that came up just in processing the level of racism was, again, how not far removed it seems, which is kind of discouraging. Like, by the end of this movie, I know that there's, like, I recognize the progress that's been made, but at the same time, I was like, Jesus, this feels very, this doesn't feel that far removed from some of the things I think about, from some of the conversations I have with my husband, the things I think about when I'm out running. It doesn't feel that far removed. At the same time, when I think about, if I'm Sidney Poitier coming into this movie, and I just can't imagine the weight of it, like the weight of this assignment, that you are going to be, first of all, the first black man to slap a white man on film. I don't even want to know what his mail looked like after that. I don't even want to know the type of just racist, vile death threats, all that that definitely came. as a result of being the first Black man to stand up for himself on camera in the face of racial violence. Like, I just don't even want to know. But to be doing all of that on camera, and you have to shoot some scenes in Tennessee, and then you actually get death threats. And then on top of that, like, him and Harry Belafonte were very big figures in the civil rights movement, like helping to fund like Dr. King's travel. Like, they had a very big role. They really did. So I'm just thinking the weight of this is immense. Because it's not just, oh, I need to get in the headspace of this character that has a different reality than my own. No, this is real life. this is real life. So there's a lot there when I think about probably what Sidney Poitier had to process in being in this film.
I hadn't even considered that. Honestly, it's good to hear that, because I honestly had never even thought about that. Mm-hmm. So outside of the racism, I mean, I don't know that the
other than that, Mrs. Lincoln, how do you like to play?
No. The other thing that struck me about this movie is that the author really did not have, I mean, and probably rightly so, I don't know that he had a very good view of police in general in small towns. Everything about that police department was just simplistic and lazy. The way they approached every single thing that they did. And it was just because this entire movie really hinges on the idea of a very lazy police department, because they didn't try to look for anybody. They just, you know, the minute they had an idea, oh, you know what, it's probably this guy, you know, that I've seen walking around the street, they just went and grabbed him. So,
I mean, I think in some cases, yes. In other cases, in any other situation, the guy who has the wallet is probably the guy who killed him. I mean, it was, you know, it's not enough to secure a case either then or now. But sure, you know, yeah. I mean, what struck me when I was watching this is I had a thought, and then I immediately had to correct my thought. The thought was, gosh, in Sparta, Mississippi, they must not have a lot of homicides. And then I thought, no, in Sparta, Mississippi, they must not have a lot of homicides with rich white victims.
Hmm.
Because these police are clearly not used to doing this work.
Interesting.
It's just not a homicide kind of town. Whereas Virgil comes from a big city where the homicide division probably is kept very busy. You know, one of my other favorites is every scene in this movie my favorite scene? It might be. But one of my other favorite scenes in this movie is when Virgil was basically performing a mini autopsy on the corpse, and you just saw his hands go across. And anyone who's ever been an actor, you know, he spent hours talking with cops going, what do you do? What do you look for? How do you hold the hand? What are you looking for in the neck? I mean, just the way he did everything so fluidly, and it was so businesslike, and he clearly knew what he was doing, and it was that level of expertise. But then it was also this really tight shot on two Black man's hands, basically touching a white man all over his body to try to see what was, I mean, it was just the way it was lit. It was just, you know, and you knew that because of that, the other three white men in that room, their blood was just boiling. Oh, so great. But yeah, this town was, you know, it's funny on your outline, Matt, you've written definitely not Mayberry. And I'm like, but it kind of is. Andy Griffith never had to deal with this case either. Mayberry, but RFD didn't have, you know, rich Chicago financiers who were caught dead in an alley. They didn't know how to do it. They just didn't know how to do it. I mean, this is a police department that gave out traffic tickets. I mean, that's all they did.
Or I guess most of the crimes would be crimes of passion. So
it's hot. It's pretty obvious. I mean, I would probably stab somebody too if I was not in air conditioning. I mean, let's be honest.
This movie is also the first movie to actually take into consideration African-American actors' complexion in when they do lighting. So the cinematography of this movie was actually very, very important. And so it kind of started getting people to think about that in filming, because a lot of times if you've filmed, you know, with standard lighting, if standard lighting works better for Caucasian people and, you know, we don't get washed out. But a lot of African Americans, the bright lights washes out a lot of features. They actually thought about that so that they could accentuate and actually have, Sidney Poitier's character look more natural on screen. And mm-hmm. That was another thing about, you know, with this movie, that was one of the firsts.
Well, I think it's so interesting how we even say standard lighting, because why is it standard? Why is white people standard?
That's a standard really for white good people.
Yeah, yeah, it's a standard for white people, but it's not a standard. And by the way, this is not over. I remember a couple years back, the cinematographer for Insecure got a whole lot of press because she actually lit black people in a way where their facial features could be more easily seen in a way that a lot of television wasn't doing. So it's not as, I mean, good for Haskell Wexler. Glad that he did all that.
What a name.
But he did not fix this problem in Hollywood. No. It is still happening today. I mean, there's a lot of places that will, you know, will say, and a lot of, actors who Jodie Turner Smith said she's actually been denied roles because her face doesn't show up well on screen. And she was like, no, you don't know how to do your job is the answer. You know, it's not that my face doesn't, there's nothing wrong with my face. You know, the problem is that Hollywood doesn't know how to film my face because white supremacy. I mean, that's
Also, when you were talking about the lighting, I was thinking of two things. One is that Google Pixel is now touting themselves as the first camera to for all skin tones. And I was also thinking about how, you know, especially black women have to really fight to get hair and makeup artists who know how to deal with their particular complexions and their particular hair and natural hair and, you know, wigs and weed and all sorts of things. And so it just continues, obviously, to this day, because they're still fighting that fight in 2022. You know,
yes, many black actresses will say they have to do their own hair.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or bring your own person with you. And then that person is now a part of your budget. So if that actor, whatever their salary is, and they're like, oh, but you didn't account for my hair and makeup. And they're like, oh, it's going to have to come out of your money. Sorry about it. You know, like it's going to have to come out of yours. So yeah, I think it's, again, it goes back to that theme of, not much has changed, and that sounds very.
Nothing's changed.
That sounds like I don't want to sound defeatist, or I don't want to sound pessimistic, but there are just so many parts of this movie. Like I was thinking about, you know, the question of like, was this a stereotypical depiction of a small town police force? And in my experience, no, no. I mean, I think about. You know, you all mentioned the show In the Heat of the Night, right? And that was filmed in Sparta, Georgia. And so when I go back to my in-laws, they live in Georgia. And so we've gone through the town, gone through Sparta, Georgia. And so very familiar with small town Georgia. In small town Georgia as well is where Ahmaud Arbery was killed in Brunswick, Georgia. And that story, that story of, again, a black man jogging past a house that had been left abandoned, whatever, two white men see him and automatically say, the first story I'm telling myself about a black man running is that he must be doing something wrong, robbing, invading. And the fact that exercise does not come to mind due to their own racism. And that's the course that they take. And they were one of them was a former police officer, you know? And so when I think about, you know, there's a question of like, oh, is this person like the screenwriter? Were they just being lazy and hating on small town police? I'm like, no, this is sadly still the reality.
It is.
When I think about Brunswick, Georgia, when I think about Ahmaud Arbery, is that it was the same thing that happened to Virgil Tibbs of, oh, I see this black person. I'm immediately associating them with crime, with a murder, with whatever, based off of my automatic assumptions. And so this is the action I'm going to take. If it can happen to Virgil Tibbs in 1967, and it happened to Ahmaud Arbery in 2020, then yeah, sadly, it can keep happening in 2022.
Which is just sad. You always want it to be better than it is, but it just never really is.
I mean, you know, look, we've made progress. I think that it's, you know, you have to hold both, right? You have to kind of say, yes, we have gone, we've traveled some distance, not nearly far enough. You know, I mean, and I just brought up George Floyd as an example of how we haven't gotten very far. Well, you know, that guy is now in jail for decades, and an almost all white jury sent him there. So that's something that would not have happened in 1967. The fact that Mr. Floyd was murdered is still awful, and it's still proof that we've got miles and miles and miles to go. But I think we do have to kind of sometimes say, yeah, it's been 55 years and some things are better and we still have work to do. If you can't, I don't know. I just feel like if you can't ever say, you know, nothing has changed and it's gotten better, then everyone just gives up. Like, why would you keep fighting if absolutely nothing has gotten better? And I think that we have to keep fighting. We have to.
Yeah, I think just really quick to that point, I think for me, there's a quote from Malcolm X that I love, where he talks about progress. And he says, if you drive a knife into my back 9 inches and pull it out 2, is that progress? The knife is still there. The knife is still in my back. It's come out 2 inches. And so I think for me, and again, I just think about, like, you know, the identities I hold as a Black person in America, as a Black woman in America, and seeing this on screen and seeing all those parallels. And it's both things can be true. Is it progress if when things were like the fact that we don't eat at separate lunch counters, is that progress if it never should have been that way? I don't think so. It doesn't. If there's an evil that never should have been in place, for me, progress doesn't mean that we do less of the evil.
Well, it's interesting too, because I think that, you know, I can obviously say this from some distance, but I didn't really breathe a sigh of relief until that train was on its way out of Sparta, Mississippi with Virgil Tibbs on it in all one piece. Like,
yes.
Because, you know, you don't realize that, you know, you're feeling sort of like that internal, you know, and then he's on his way. Goodbye. Don't ever come back. Stay in Philadelphia. Like,
stay in Philly. Stay in Philly.
There was a sequel to this movie, but I think it took place in Philly. So I think he heeded our advice there.
California.
Oh, it was California.
California. It took place in Los Angeles.
Was it called In the Cool of the Night?
I believe it was called They Call Me Mr. Tibbs.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
There's the author wrote 3 books. So I believe that was one of the other books.
Well, trilogy. Well, Tibbs trilogy. I like it.
Are you all ready for some fun facts?
Some fun facts. Fun fact?
Bring it.
The title song was written by Quincy Jones. The other song in the movie that was written by Quincy Jones was Foul Owl on the Prowl. So that's that song that Ralph plays in the diner, that really bizarre song.
I love that song.
That was actually, it was written by Quincy Jones. They couldn't get the rights to Little Red Riding Hood by Sam the Sham and the Pharaohs.
The names in 1960 are wild. The group names are just, they get wilder and wilder. Yep. Like Sam the Sham and the Pharaohs. Like, what are we even?
I have no idea what Foul Owl on the Prowl means, but I like that song. When he played it, I'm like, what is this song? I like the song.
He wrote it so it would be very similar to the feeling of Little Red Riding Hood.
Okay.
Quincy Jones, genius. Genius.
They also filmed this movie in the autumn in Illinois, even though it's supposed to be in the summer in Mississippi. So a lot of the actors actually would keep ice chips in their mouth before they would do their lines so that you wouldn't see their breath when they were actually on screen, because a lot of this is filmed outside.
I saw the breath when they, and thank you, this is very validating for me, because I didn't realize that they shot it in Illinois, and it's the scene where they're outside of the diner.
Yep, I saw it too.
And Gillespie, and they're all talking outside the diner, and I saw their breath, and I was like, what are we doing here? So thank you. I feel vindicated.
That's just how humid it was, is that just, you couldn't put any more moisture into the air.
I was like, it looks very cold. What's going on? Am I being bamboozled? I was a little bit, yes.
And then finally, Mr. Tibbs is the 19th most heroic character on AFI's list of 100 years, 100 heroes and villains.
As he should be.
Mm-hmm. Fair.
Number one.
Ooh, that's a good question.
Of course you would ask me that, and I haven't looked it
it's
up.
Probably what's his face. It's probably what's his face from To Kill a Mockingbird.
Atticus.
Oh, Atticus.
Yeah.
Gregory Peck.
Yeah, yeah. Atticus Finch. I bet you that's who it is. Mm-hmm. I will follow up with the people who I'm sure are dying to know. Yes.
Or, you know, Batman. One of the other.
Okay, y'all ready for a game?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Play a game.
So we are going to play Casting Couch, okay? Hollywood has run out of ideas, and so it's going back to the classics and remaking them, a la Disney, and remaking every animated film into a live-action version that we don't need. So we are going to remake In the Heat of the Night, okay? I want you to cast some of the main characters. Tell me who directs, and tell me if there's anything you want to change. If you want to do a direct remake with no changes, feel free. But if there are some changes, tell us what they are. So we are going to go guest first. Mm-hmm. So, Janna, how about you?
Okay. Let me do the cast first, and then I will give you the revamp In the Heat of the Night, the directorial changes. So cast as Mr. Tibbs, as Virgil Tibbs, I'm going to pick Jonathan Majors.
Oh, I love him.
Yes. Everyone familiar with Jonathan Majors has starred in The Harder They Fall, has starred in Lovecraft Country.
Okay.
I just started Lovecraft Country. I'm like obsessed with it. It's so good.
It's very, very good. But whenever I was watching, I was like, who am I? When I watched the movie, honestly, the first actor I really thought of was Chadwick Boseman. And that's because Chadwick Boseman in interviews has that same Sidney Poitier philosophy about being very deliberate about the roles that he took and wanting to portraying Thurgood Marshall, portraying James Brown, portraying Jackie Robinson, and like all of these big roles that were great for representation for Black folks. I was like, I know he's passed away. I was like, ooh, Jonathan Majors. Jonathan Majors has that. And I'm thinking of him in The Harder They Fall. Like, he's a great, complicated hero, at least in that movie. I really like him. So I have him as Mr. Tibbs. As the chief, I'm going to do Jesse Plemons.
Oh, ooh. That's so good. It's so
good. Don't you see it? Yes. Don't you see it?
100%.
Yes. Okay, so Jesse Plemons as the chief. I think the point of reference that made me think of him was I love Jesse Plemons in everything, but most recently in Judas and the Black Messiah, when he plays the detective that gets Lakeith Stanfield to infiltrate the Black Panthers. I was like, ooh, he has some background working. He has some background in a law enforcement role. I think that could be good. The only other character that I've actually thought through are two of them. As Sam Wood, I would have Adam Driver. Hear me out. Hear me out.
Okay.
I think he could give Sam Wood some range. I think he could. So okay. that's my defense of Adam Driver.
All right.
In the Mama Kaliba role, I'm gonna give her more screen time in my directorial edit. So I'm gonna go with Viola Davis. I love Viola Davis in anything. I'm gonna put Viola Davis in anything I ever do. So my director, my twist on this, is because I just saw Nope. It would be Jordan Peele, and I want it to be
so good.
Want it to be that like socio commentary horror that he gave us with Get Out. That's what I want.
Oh, that's what I want.
So I want it to have that. Yeah, I want it to just feel a little bit scarier, because also I feel like the name, like In the Heat of the Night, sounds kind of scary. It can either go scary or sexy. There's one of two ways it can go. Like, so I want to lean more towards the scary. So yeah, I would pick Jordan Peele and give it more of that kind of horror twist.
I like that a lot.
I love him.
I'm going to go according to my screen here. So I'm going to go Allie next.
Great, because I'm very excited about this cast that I put together. So I decided that we were going to do a little Wire reunion. Okay, so Mr. Idris Elba was going to be my Virgil Tibbs.
He was on my list. He was on my list.
Because I do think he brings that gravitas that Sidney Poitier brings to all of his roles.
Yeah, I see it.
So we're going to go in a little bit of a different direction because I'm forcing this Wire reunion. And Mike Gillespie is going to be Dominic West.
I see.
A little bit different, but you know, they've obviously played off of each other, and I love Dominic West, and I would never kick him out of bed, and I can't believe he's going to be Prince Charles in the new Crown. That just kind of blows my mind. For my Mrs. Colbert, I'm going to cast Amy Ryan, who obviously had a part in The Wire. I feel like she doesn't do a lot of work these days, and I feel she's so brilliant.
She's so great.
And I feel like she could do that role in her sleep. My Harvey Oberst is going to be Pablo Schreiber.
Okay.
Because I feel, you know, again, why a reunion? And I just, I love him too. He was so evil in SVU. I don't know if any of you are SVU fans, but he had like a crazy walk. So one of my twists is that I am making Ralph Henshaw black. So Michael B. Jordan is going to be my Ralph Henshaw. And so that's going to give a little bit of a twist at the end. The twist is already there. It's going to layer it even more that it is a black man that walks in through their shadows. And what does that mean for the town? What does that mean for Virgil Tibbs? What does that mean for the chief? Wow. And I, you know, I think that this just has to be a Spike Lee joint. That's my, updated in the heat of the night.
Okay.
I see it.
I like it. I like it.
Woodsy.
Eric.
Okay. I thought way too hard about this game. My Mr. Tibbs, I had Michael B. Jordan on my list. I had Idris Elba on my list. Both of them seemed a little obvious to me. Have y'all seen Severance?
Yes.
Okay. So Mr. Tibbs is Tremell Tillman, who plays Mr. Milchick on Severance. Because he's so... Anybody who can look that good with a porn stash and those white short sleeve shirt business like, oh my God. And that, you know, he rocks a blazer and a turtleneck and makes it look good.
He sure does. And the dance scene.
My God. He is, he hasn't done much, but I think he is so amazing in that role. Yep. I bet he can do it. I bet he can do it. My Gillespie, I cast Hugh Bonneville. Sir Robert Crawley from Downton Abbey.
Oh! Because
he's got a little bit of that chubby kind of, you know, aspect to him, but he does have this, and okay, at me if you want to, like, I don't think that Rod Steiger is hot by any means, but he kind of has this lovable little pudgy face, right? And so it works well against the abject racism. And so I think bringing in Hugh Bonneville and then letting him say some vile racist shit would just make people go, oh my God. So there was that. Mrs. Colbert, I love Lee Grant. I love her. But I thought that character should have been older. I thought that there was maybe be a little bit more, like, I believe that she could run this whole business out of town if she had a little. So I cast Annette Bening in that role. Because I think she'd play the emotional scene really well. But then when she recovered herself and she was down to business telling the mayor what's what, I could see her doing that. My Harvey was Lucas Hedges. I don't know if you're familiar with him, but he had a great role in Manchester by the Sea. And he's awfully good. My Ralph, I guess Pete Davidson, because he just looks like, you know, I don't know why Allie was so determined to make Ralph fuckable, but I don't think that's the right move for Ralph. So I went in another direction.
I mean, I've got to think for Pete Davidson, so that's, you know.
You noticed that the hotness correspondent did not weigh in this movie.
You and Kim K. All right. My Officer Wood, I cast Jim Parsons, because he can do drama, but he can also be that kind of guy that's like, oh, just shape up. Oh, just do better, will ya? I mean, it's just do better.
Yeah.
And then my Mama Kaleba, I also love Viola Davis, but there is an actress who I also really admire who I think has not gotten enough work, not nearly enough work recently, because everyone's like, they all run to get Viola. And that is Elfrey Woodard, who's just standing there, who is so brilliant in everything. So she shows up on my games all the time on this show because I just think she's so underappreciated and so amazing. So I could see her rocking that scene.
Yeah. You're so right.
My directors are Adil El Arbi and Bilal Fallah, who were just found out that their last month, they found out that the movie they've been working on for a year, Batgirl, was unceremoniously canceled by HBO and Discovery. They are also responsible for Ms. Marvel on Disney Plus, which was amazing. So it might be a little bit of a pity vote, but it's also because they're really great filmmakers. And I think that when they are making work that's both kind of got that adventure feeling to it, but also has really important things to say about race and representation, they can do that. And they do it from kind of an outside the typical U.S., you know, conversation about that. As two Muslims who do hail from the Middle East, they see the United States with maybe a little bit more objectivity than an American director might. And I think that they would be able to nail a lot of this great stuff. So that was, and my twist on this whole thing was that, to Janna's point, we're setting this one in 2022.
Yes.
It is not going to be a period piece. It's just like the first movie was, it's going to be, this is America, folks. Look in the mirror. This is where you live.
Yep. Oh man, I'm so disappointed in myself for not choosing Alfred Woodard. Oh my God.
Viola Davis, no chicken either. I mean, you know, that's.
Listen, that. Oh man, but I could see it. I could see it.
An abundance of riches, really.
Yes.
Okay, so on my list, I was thinking the same thing you were, but I just changed my Virgil Tibbs to Jeffrey Wright now instead of being Jonathan. Because I was thinking Lovecraft County too, and I just, he has got such an intensity on screen.
Yes.
But you know what? I'll go in a different universe. We'll pull Jeffrey Wright.
Mm-hmm.
I like Jeffrey Wright because he's a little bit older, and I kind of feel he's been experienced, and that'll give him a little bit more experience in trying to kind of quell some of the passion that's going to come up as he's having to deal with all these people.
And you can also reference his work as Commissioner Gordon, I think would come in real handy. Kidding. I'm kidding.
He was absolutely brilliant in Westworld. Oh my
God.
He was
so good.
He and Candy Newton were the best parts of that show. Sheriff Gillespie, I'm going to cast Danny McBride.
Okay.
Have you guys been watching The Righteous Gemstones?
Yes. Oh, I love The Righteous Gemstones.
I need to watch that. That's
show.
Like, I love a scam nation situation. Like, I love a religious scam nation. So I need to watch that.
It is hilarious. Okay. I'm here for that. I think, yeah.
I think his character there has got Sheriff Gillespie written all over
yes.
it.
Yes. Ooh, that's a good pick.
Mrs. Colbert is going to be played by Jennifer Connelly.
Okay.
I went a little bit sexier. I like Jennifer Connelly is kind of no nonsense, and I think that's who I want my Mrs. Colbert to be.
Mm-hmm. She's so pretty.
And Harvey Obrist is going to be played by Landon Lieberon, which you guys probably have never heard of.
No, sir.
There is a show on Netflix called Hemlock Grove, which if you like kind of trashy horror TV shows that are based on adolescent books, this is a great show. With at least,
well,
the
with
first
that
season.
Kind of pitch,
I was gonna say, it's a real niche genre.
I absolutely love the show. It's got my next character in there. So I'm doing away with Ralph. I mean, he can be in the show, but he's not going to be the end game. It is actually going to be Mr. Purdy. And Mr. Purdy is going to be played by Bill Skarsgård, who also was in Hemlock Grove.
He was Pennywise in it.
Yes, so creepy.
Pennywise in it. Yeah, he's a very good actor. And I think he can, you know, he'll bring a creepiness level that we need. But it's going to be Mr. Purdy is going to be our... it's going to be all in the film.
And is he? So he is boinking his sister. He got his sister pregnant.
He is boinking
okay.
his sister. That's
so we have a little
happen.
Bit of a Jamie Cersei situation happening.
Yep.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's 2022. I think we're ready for that story.
Are we
ready?
I am also going to give Jess a bigger character. Jess and Mama Kleba. So Jess is going to be played by Craig Robinson.
I'm about it.
And then Mama Kleba is going to be played by Tisha Campbell.
Yes.
I'm here for the Tisha Sans.
Yes.
I loved her in Uncoupled. She was so much fun.
She's on my brain.
I haven't watched Uncoupled. So she's Neil Patrick Harris's friend, best friend.
Business partner.
Okay. All right. It's on my to watch list. Yes.
And she's great. Okay. The reason I want to give them more of a role is I kind of feel like in that city, they were the people that were just kind of ignored. But generally the people that are ignored are the people that know what the fuck is going on, and they know everybody else's shit.
Right.
So really, Tibbs should have been going and talking to them. He's like, okay, so this is what I think is going on. What's really going on? Because the people talk in front of them because they think that they don't exist and they don't matter. So I want to bring that into this movie and bring that reality into this movie. So and I'm going to have F. Gary Gray actually direct this. So Friday, Set It Off, and The Negotiator.
Wow.
I can quote the entire script of Friday. I have probably watched it 150 times.
Oh.
Yeah, it's one of my favorite movies.
Also, what can you also quote next Friday and Friday after next? No, I will be very impressed.
But I can quote Boomerang from start to finish as well.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, man, I want to see all of these. Yes. I want to see every last one.
I mean, there's not one of these that I wouldn't watch. Those all sound really good. Hollywood, call us.
What is wrong with you? We're so good at this.
Yep. So next up brings us to Skip, Rent, or Buy. So for those that have not listened before, Skip, this movie is garbage. Why would you waste your time? Rent, this is worth a watch. I'm glad I watched it. I might not watch it again. And Buy, I should pull this out at least once a year and be rewatching this. This is just that important to me. So let's go in reverse order. Eric, Skip, Rent, or Buy?
I think when I started out with this conversation, I was hovering around the Rent, maybe closer to a Rent with a Buy rising. But honestly, talking about it, I really want to watch it again, like right now. So I think I have upgraded. I think I'm a buy on this one. It's not an easy film to watch, but I have a suspicion that this movie would reward multiple viewings. I think I would catch more the second time. And I think that just the little, just those amazing performances, I want to see them again. I want to see it again, knowing what's happening. I want to spend a little bit, maybe more attention to Ralph this time, just to kind of see what other hints are kind of there. I'm a solid buy on In the Heat of the Night.
I also enjoyed this conversation, but I'm a Rent, very solid Rent. I enjoyed this movie. I did not know really very much anything about it. And I thought it was very eye-opening in all the reasons that we talked about today. And yeah, solid Rent. And, you know, just a follow-up from before, Atticus Finch was the number one hero, by the way. So
I was called it.
Yeah, so it's a good trivia question. You know, I think it's the number one hero. But yeah, solid Rent. I don't know that I've would need to see it again. I mean, if somebody was like, I've never seen In the Heat of the Night before, I probably would join them. But yeah, definitely rent.
So funny story, we bought the movie, but my husband and I were like, this was a rent situation for us. But I am glad we bought it for some of the reasons that Eric listed, like just even thinking about the cinematography pieces, because I did find myself thinking that I'm like, I'm really seeing a lot of definition on Sidney Poitier's face, and this is 1967. This is not the cinematographer for Insecure. Somebody did a good job. And so now hearing what you've said and the fun facts, I'm like, okay, I want to go back and watch it. I think purely from a content perspective, it's Rent, because I just want more for Black stories. There's a lot to Black people outside of racism and our experiences in relation to white supremacy. And so I really just want to see more stories outside of that. So I don't think this would be one I'd like watch annually for inspiration necessarily, but it is one that it's stuck with me. And especially now I know some of the references I heard growing up of, they call me Mr. T. Like now I can be like, oh, I know the exact scene where that comes from. But yeah, I think viewing it once for good measure, that's enough for me. So yeah, solid Rent as well.
And I'm going to follow it up with a solid Rent as well. I think this is a must see movie. You should see it at least once in your life. You definitely need to watch this movie. I would watch it again if friends wanted to. I don't know that I'm going to seek it out to watch it again. So that's three rents and a buy. Good movie. Well, thank you, everybody. Thank you, Janna.
Thank you, Janna,
for joining us.
Happy, I mean, this is great.
We hope you'll come back, maybe with something a little bit more lighthearted.
Yeah, let me know when you guys are doing a recap of LeBron Space Jam. Yeah. Happy to give my thoughts. Happy to, if y'all ever want to talk about Broadway stuff, like Lea Michele's coming back for Funny Girl.
I am a gossip hound, and I'm shook.
Some feelings.
I do too.
I have a lot of feelings. But yeah, call me up anytime. Eric knows where I am. But I love this conversation. I love this project, what y'all are doing. And it's really, really great to have conversations like these. We need more of them. Really, 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 we do. So thank y'all for having it.
Thanks for being here.
Thanks. Thank you. Well, and thank you all for listening. Please join us again next time when we'll be talking about The Manchurian Candidate.
That's going to be a live podcast. We are just about to record that episode at the DC Public Library. We've got some friends over there. So we've never done a live podcast with a live audience before. So in 2 weeks, join us for that one, because this should be fun to listen to.
Until then, be kind. Rewind.
You've been listening to The Rewind Project. You can find us wherever you get your podcasts, including Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Radio Public, and Google Play. Please subscribe and rate us. It helps a lot. We love your comments and questions. You can find us on Facebook, Twitter, and via our new phone number at 202-618-2402. Thanks for listening. Be kind. Rewind.
Not a euphemism, like legit, that we're actually talking about a pie.